towards the end of yesterday's class, we went a little quickly. So I'll just backtrack a little bit and just repeat some of the things. If you have any questions, you can ask at any time. So let's get started. So yesterday, I think the last thing we talked about was using addresses so that we can limit the which records Awk executes its command on. Remember? So till now we were working with lines. So you can limit a command to work on certain lines by giving them addresses. So addresses can be line numbers or regular expressions or any expression in Awk. So you remember this example from yesterday. What this does is, this is the address and this is the action, okay, the command. So this command is executed for every line that for which this regular expression is satisfied. That means if it begins, okay, and this one negates that regular expression. So this works for any line that begins with anything other than a C. Right, remember? Now if you wanted to, you can use any regular expression here. Suppose you wanted the lines which are having C or B. Okay, you could use something like this. Right? Remember bar character? It does an alternation. So it's C or B, and that's anchored to the beginning of the line. Okay, so any kind of regular expression you can give over here, that regular expression is matched with the entire record. So here the record is a line. If it matches, whatever is inside the action is going to be executed. Yeah, so yesterday I quickly talked about some...
Capturing parentheses, we need backspace
here. No, over here you don't need it. Okay, so Awk supports extended regular expressions. That means you don't need to escape... Something wrong. Okay, so you don't need to escape any of the... you don't need to escape plus, dot, star, okay, brackets, and the pipe, the bar. You don't need to escape any of these. So it's extended regular expression for Awk. Yeah, unlike sed. Now, yesterday I told you that there are some variables in Awk which it sets automatically while it's running. As it's reading records from the input, it's going to be setting these variables. So you can use these variables to know, to get some information from Awk about how its processing is going on. For example, the NF variables tells you how many fields are there in your current record. Okay, so in our earlier example, the record was a line, and each line was split into words. So these words are the fields. So depending on how many words you have in your line, they're going to be split into any number of fields, like one or two or more. So suppose you had a file which had an unequal number of fields on each line. So you could know how many fields are there on each line by looking at the NF variable. Now the NR variable tells you which is the record it is processing right now. Okay, until now records are lines. So NR is the number of records. So the first line would be NR equals to 1. The second one would be NR equals to 2. So NR tells you which record is being processed right now. So when your record is, NR equals to 1 is for the first line, NR equals to 2 is the second line. So you can know which line you're on by looking at the NR variable. Now the RS, FS, ORS, OFS variables, these tell you, this is a record separator, field separator, we'll be using these. Okay, these are variables which you can set yourself. So this is where we stopped yesterday. So remember, I told you that unlike sed, you can't use line numbers directly in your address over here in Awk. So you need to put an expression over here. This can be some arithmetic expression. Okay, it can even be a string comparison. Any expression that returns a true or false value. So a true value is 1. A true value is non-zero, and a false value is 0. So this expression, nr modulus 2 equal to 0, this returns true if the line number is a multiple of 2. Okay? So it picks evens lines. This is a modulo operator, it returns the remainder. So this is the kind of expression you can put over here. Now look at this expression. This is also an address. We're checking if the field number 1, if the first field is equal to the character C. Okay, here we're using equal to. Right? So it checks if the first field. So this is exactly the same as what I showed you earlier. Right? These both do the same thing. This checks if the first character is C. and this checks if the first field is C. And you'll notice there's a small difference. Okay? I'll maybe illustrate an example later. Now look at this. We can give a range. We can give a range of addresses for our awk command. So we have two regular expressions here. We have two regular expressions here separated by a comma. So this first one tells, so what does this address mean? This address says process all lines between the line that matches this regular expression and the line that matches this regular expression. Okay, so your awk is going to be scanning lines. As soon as it finds a line which matches this regular expression, it's going to start processing. And it's going to process all the lines following that until it reaches a line which matches this regular expression. Okay, and then it's going to stop. So it's going to do all the lines in between these two, including them, including both of them. And then it will stop. Now suppose it never finds a line which is matching this, it's going to do all the lines until the end. Okay, until the file ends. Now you can mix and match between regular expressions and other arithmetic expressions. So look at this. So again we have a range. We have a caret C, that means this regular expression says all lines beginning with the character C. And this one stands for record number equals to 7. Okay. So what does this do? This starts processing on the first line that has C as the first character. And then it continues processing. It prints all those lines until it reaches a line which has until it reaches line number 7. Okay, so you can mix expressions like this. So remember, when you see a comma, that's a range. Okay, so you can start somewhere and end somewhere.
So it will print up to 6 lines? Or 7th line also it will print?
It will print the 7th line.
Also.
But if C comes after line number 7?
Yeah, then it won't print anything. So if C came after 7th line, it would start printing after that C. But then it would not stop until it reaches the end of the file. Because this condition will never become true. So just keep printing until it reaches the end of the file. Now we were talking about records and fields all this time. Now we'll actually start using that concept. So by default, awk considers a single line as a record. So if you don't provide any options, if you don't change any variables, awk considers one line as a record. And within this record, it separates each word, okay, each space separated word, white space to be more accurate, white space separated word as a field. Okay, so this is the default. So what does this mean? So how does awk know that it has read one line in from input, from standard input? It looks for a new line character. Okay, new line character. That's just an ASCII character just like any other character. It's an ASCII value. When it sees this value, awk knows that it has read in one line. Okay, it stops. Okay? And how does it know that it has to separate a word? It looks for white space. Okay, that means spaces or tabs. Anything like that, okay? Usually spaces and tabs. When it sees a space, one or more spaces or one or more tabs, it knows that it has finished picking up one field and then separates to the next field. Okay, so generally when you have words on a line, they're separated by spaces or tabs. And awk automatically separates them based on that. So what's this the space and tab and the new line character? This is called the record separator. Okay, record separator. So we call the record separator because whenever awk sees this record, it knows that one record is complete and the next record has begun, right? And when it sees a space or a tab or one or more spaces and tabs, it knows that one field is complete and the next field has started. So this is a field separator. So by changing this variable, so the fs variable is what specifies your field separator, and the rs variable is what sets your record separator. Now, by default, rs is a new line character, and fs is the tab or spaces. Okay, that's a default. Now, by changing this default, you can change how awk actually reads its files. What does it interpret as a record, and what is a field? Okay, maybe you will get files which are not arranged like what we showed until now. I'll show you some examples about that. Now look at this Unix password file. Okay, this is a file which you'll find on all Unix systems. I'll just cat it over here. Okay, look at this file. It's got one line. So this file contains information about every user on a Unix system. Okay, every user account. Right? So look. name of the user, it's got some information, this is supposed to be the password, it's got the user user ID, group ID, and a name for that user, their home directory, a lot of information in the shell. Now you can see that each field, each piece of information, so the name and the password field and the user ID, group ID, they're all separated by a colon instead of a space. Okay, so here the field separated with a colon, not a white space. So we need to tell awk. So suppose you pass this to awk. And you wanted to print the first field. Right? You're printing field 1. Now it's not going to work properly. It's not just printing the fields properly. It's looking for a space. But it's not able to find a space, so it's printing the whole thing. So we need to tell awk. We need to tell awk that it's supposed to look for a colon as a field separator. So what we'll do is we'll put a begin block. So we'll be setting this variable, field separator fs variable, in the begin block so that it executes the fs command before anything else, before any line is ready. So you just simply set the variable like this, fs equals to, that's it. You just put field separator equals to the colon capital. You put it in between quotes, okay, it's a string. Now let's try it again. So it looks like it works, okay, it's splitting up the, it's splitting up along the colons. So you can also do this for any other field. You can do 2, 3, whatever, sort of print. Okay, so this is how the fs variable affects how awk is going to split your input, okay, automatic splitting. Okay, now we'll go, so okay, now I showed you an example of how to use the fs variable to change how awk reads the input. Now we'll do something with the RS variable, with the record separator variable. So before I show you this, I'll be describing a file called nbox. Okay, it's nbox file. So this file you'll find on many Unix systems. Okay, it's usually sometimes in your home directory. What an nbox file is that it's a file for storing all your emails. Okay, all your emails in one file. Okay, so suppose you have an email program that receives email, or you have send mail something running. Whenever you receive email, instead of storing each message as a separate file, it just puts all your messages into one single file, nbox. So how does it store these files into a single file? How does it know when one message is ending and the next message begins? You have to set the boundaries and stuff. So nbox is like a standardized format. Okay, there's a standard for it, telling how the file is supposed to be formatted. So basically in an nbox file, every email is just added one after the other. Okay, so suppose you have 3 emails, the first email message is added to the nbox file, and at the end of that, the second email message is added. Now between 2 email messages, you have one blank line. Okay, just one blank line. So what's a blank line? It's just a line with a new line character on it. Okay, just a blank line. And now how do you know that a message has begun? How do you know a message has begun? So every message begins with a special formatted starting search. Okay? So I didn't put this on slide because the file is a little big. So look at this first line. Okay, this is the beginning of a message. It has the words from, space, okay, an email address, a time. That's it. Okay. So now if you look at the next message, so this is one message. We'll scroll down. This is the body of the message. Now we reach the next message. This is the second message. Look at that. It begins with something similar. Okay, from, space, email address, timestamp. Okay, this is standardized. Okay, this is in the nbox standard. So you have to have this over here. You have to have something like this in the beginning of the message. So now we know we have some standard, we have some rule on where one message ends and the next message begins. Okay, so we look for this. Now the email address can change and the timestamp can change, but the from doesn't change. So I told you that before, when every message ends, there's a blank line before it, right? A blank line is there after every message. So this is that blank line. So what do we look for? What is our record separator over here? How do we know that one message ends and the next one has begun? Okay, we look for a blank line and the words from separated by a space. Okay, So we look for new line from space. Now that is our field record separator. Now what do you think would be the, now we can, by default the field separator is a space, right? So if you set the record separator as this, okay, it's going to read a whole message as a record. And then it's going to do its automatic splitting. So awk does the automatic splitting. But what's the default? The default is going to split along words. So you'll get every word as one field. Okay, $1, $2, you're going to get a lot of fields. So what do you think would be a better way to split the record? So you have an email message, you want to split it into something convenient. Okay, one way of splitting it is splitting along lines. Suppose you want one line, suppose you want line 1 to be $1, line 2 to be $2, line 3, $3, like that. Okay, that would be nice. We can get each line of our email message as one field. So now we know our record separator. Our record separator is what? This is our record separator. So our record separator is one empty line, yes, a new line, the word from, and a space. Okay, this is our record separator. Okay, so you should put two new lines over here. Okay. A new line and new line. So why are we doing new line, new line? So this is the last line of our message, previous message. So there's a new line over here. Okay, that's how you get this line. And then there's a new line over here. Okay, so actually we're looking for two new lines. Two new lines means a blank line, right? So this line ends with a new line. We have a new line here, and then from. So that's why we're looking for two new lines. New line, from, and a space. This is our record separator. And what will be our field separator? You want to split along lines.
Slash n.
New line.
Slash n.
Yeah. You could also use caret dollar.
Caret dollar, yeah. So the awk language, I told you awk is a language, right?
Yeah.
So in the original awk language, and if you see the original implementation of awk, record separators and field separators have to be exactly one character. Okay, they have to be one character. But this is the GNU implementation of awk, and it supports regular expressions and strings as record and field separators. So yes, you can use a regular expression. And so you can think of this as a regular expression, but we're not using any of the meta characters. So yes, you can use a regular expression. So let's use that. So this is what we were talking about. This is a field separator and a record separator. We'll use this line. Let's see what it does. Atom box, 5-bit to awk. Now we'll set our variables in a begin block. The record separator equals to new line from space. And put a semicolon because we're writing our next statement within the block. Field separator equals to new line. Close our block. Now what do you want to do in a block? Let's suppose you want to print the first email message. So you put nr equal to 1 and just print. So if you just put a print by itself, what does it mean? It's going to print every field. Okay, every field. So it's just going to go up, so we'll pipe it through less. So see, this is the first message. You'll see that only one is there. That's it. We got a, we extract the first message. Now suppose you want to get the second one. You will put nr equals to 2 over here. This is the second email message. That's it. Now you'll notice something. Look at the first email message. And look at the first line. Look at the first line, that's our record separator. Now look for the second one. Okay. The from is missing over there. Okay. So by default, what does awk do? Okay, what does awk do? By default, awk is going to remove the record separator. Whatever record separator you have, it's going to remove it. So awk assumes that the record separator is not part of your data. Okay. So whenever you have a record separator or field separator, it removes it from your data. So from your fields and your records, you won't find the record separator data. Whatever you set as a record separator. So why is it there for the first message? So it's not there for the second one, the third one, for all of them, except for the first one. It's there for the first one.
There is no slash on here.
Okay, it's not. Okay, I'll tell you why. So the record separator is what awk looks for as the ending of a record. Okay, so awk is going to start reading your input. It sees that it reached record separator. It knows that the record has ended. Okay, and then it starts reading the second record. Now by default, okay, awk assumes that the first record begins at the beginning of the file. So it does not look for the record separator in the beginning of your file. It just assumes that the starting of the file is your first record. Okay, so it doesn't matter whether you have that record separator over there in the beginning. Even if it's not there, it's going to assume that your first record begins on the first line of your file. Okay, so that's why, since it did not look for the from, it did not actually remove it. It did not even look for it over there. Okay? So you'll find this happening a lot. In your first record, it doesn't look for a record separator. It actually looks at the end. So the record separator marks the end of one message. And then when it reaches the record separator, it's going to remove that record separator and then start processing the second record.
So even if one blank line is there in the beginning?
Yes, even if one blank line is there in the beginning. It's going to assume that it's So, okay, so what will happen? Suppose you had two blank lines in the beginning. Two blank lines. What's going to happen? So it's gonna find one blank line, okay, then it's gonna find two new line characters and then a from. So what awk is gonna think is it's gonna think that the first blank line is your first record. So that's not what you want. Okay, it's gonna think that the first line, so you'll get your, if you put nr equals to 1 and print it, you're gonna get just a blank line. Okay, because it started assuming that the first line is the record, and then after processing the first line, it found your record separator. So it thinks, okay, the first record is over, we're going to start the second record. So you need to be a little careful about the beginning of your file, what's contained over there. So you want to prevent, you want to avoid having spaces or blank lines at the beginning of your file.
Is it two lines will be sufficient in that case? Two blank lines?
Two
or
lines, yeah, you would have to have three.
Three,
yeah. Three. So like I said, the record separator is not part of the record except for the first one. Okay.
If you for the last
message.
So if I include in printed dollar in
the like. Oh yes, yeah. So you can extract any line from your so this will print the second email message. Suppose you're asking like this, $1?
Yeah, dollar in and maybe the last one.
Okay, so $1 will print the first line of your email. And $2 the second.
No, I'm asking if it wants the last message, then before, outside the print comment.
So awk is processing records. One by one, right? So you can't tell beforehand which is the last record. Okay, so it can't know. For example, you could have email messages coming, live. You could pipe some kind of a mail reader into awk, and it could be reading messages as they come. So awk never really knows which is the last record. It knows only the first one. So you have to put a number over there. You have to put nr equals to.
Can you run a command to know what is your maximum number for nr?
So after awk runs, okay, suppose the input ended, and then if you pipe the output of awk into some file, then you could find how many. So awk by itself does not count how many lines. It's processing one record at a time. So it never really knows when the input is going to end. Awk never knows when the input is going to end. So even if you're reading the input from a file, it just processes one record at a time.
Can we just run awk without printing and just record number of things it has read?
Yeah, so if you put a, suppose you put a print NR in your end block. Okay, you remember begin and the end block? So you put a print NR in the end block. It's going to count the number of lines in your file. That's what you're asking?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah. So, yeah, you can make it print the number of lines once the input is complete. But it can never know before. For example, in the begin block, you can never know how many NRs are in the reader. So, I'll just show you a couple of more examples. Since it's not on the slides, the files are a little big. So I'll just show it to you here on the terminal. Look at this file. Okay. This file is given to me by a colleague. It's some climate data. Okay. Some climate data. What it has is a date. It has a date and five fields, five floating point numbers. So these floating point numbers are some climate data, okay? some temperature, some reflectance, something like that. Okay, we don't care about that. But what is it? What it shows is that it gives each month. Okay, so this is the 1st January, okay, and 1st February, 1st March. Okay, it has a monthly. Each line is 1 month of data. Okay. So what we want to do, what this person wanted to do is they want to convert this monthly data into annual data. For this first field, okay, for any field. Suppose we wanted to take the average of this for 12 months and print out the average over a year. Okay? So how do we do that? Now you could write a Fortran program to do this, but how can we do it in awk? In fact, you don't even have to write program, you can just do it really on the command line. How do you do it? No, we don't. Okay, so we're not talking about field and record separately. We're just showing a general example of what you can do practically with awk. Yes, yeah. So you need to accumulate the values. Like, you remember the average which we found? Sorry, not the average, the total, the column total. We need to do something like that. But we needed to print the output for every 12 months. Yeah, you can do that.
Or you can use NR
modulo.
Range.
Yeah. So, okay, I mean, if anybody has any other suggestions how you could do it, I could just show you the solution. So you could look for the year. You could look, okay, I'll just show you the data once again. You could do something by looking at this year, but let's assume this file is structured well. Okay, so we have all our data. Now suppose you had missing data. Suppose 1 month was missing in between. In that case, you would have to base your program on this date. So what you would do, you would make your program look at the month. Okay, so when it reaches month 12, you need to do some calculation. 12 months was missing, yeah, okay. So, yeah, so.
Better is here.
Okay, yeah, so yeah, 1 year is good. Okay, you don't have to look, you can look for a change in the year. Okay, for a change in the year, so 1 year changing. So you look at the year, as when the year changes, you sum it up and print the average. Okay, maybe you can write that next. So let's see how this simple case works, where we'll assume that the data is good and it's got all the values, nothing's missing. So what would we put in the awk statement? A begin block? Okay. So we put something like total equal to 0. Right? Okay, now you have your other block. So the begin block executes once. Now we have a block which executes for every line. So what should we do with that?
Search for $2 modulo 12 is equal to 0. Then you have to print.
Okay, but we need to add the values.
Total equal to plus.
What? total equals to?
Total plus
equals to. Okay, so now what it does is it's going to set total equals to 0, and for every line of the file it's going to add $2 to that total. But now, not yet complete, right? Okay, so let's start with a simple case and assume that it begins with January and all the months are there. So every 12th line is December. So what will you put? Exactly, yeah. So we need to, once we complete a 12-month cycle, we need to reset total to 0 back again. Okay, otherwise it's just going to keep adding stuff. So, so what do you do? Where do you need to reset total to 0?
After
printing it, right? Okay, so let's put it here. Total equal to 0. Right? So it works. Not works. So we got, so let's count the number of lines in the output. Okay. This command exercise So if you want to know how many lines are there in the output, you just pipe it through this command wc-l. Okay, it tells you how many lines are there in the output. So you'll see it's got 41 lines. And if you look at the input and see how many lines are there, 503. Okay. So what? Is that right? Okay. Remember arithmetic substitution? Okay. That's how you do quick calculation machine. Okay. Now you could use BC. Now there's a problem with doing something like this, okay? Okay? Whatever you get, the result is rounded to an integer. So it's not really the right thing to do. Because I told you that the shell doesn't understand floating point numbers. So you really shouldn't be doing this if you are expecting a floating point number to come. Okay, because it will round it to an integer. Okay, so you got a program here that quickly changes monthly climate data into annual data. Now this begin block over here, you don't really need it to be there. So in yesterday's example, I put this begin block. Okay. You don't really need it to be there because whenever you use a variable like total, whenever you use a variable total, like for the first time in an awk program, the first time you reference a variable, its value is guaranteed to be 0. Okay. So when I use a value, when you use a variable for the first time, its value is 0. This is unlike C. Okay. So in C, if you use an uninitialized variable, it's going to have any random number in it. So in awk, it's part of the awk language. The standard says that any variable which you're using for the first time is 0. So we don't need to put that begin block over there. So it makes our program even more compact. So you get the same result. Now I want to show you something. Look at the same program written in a script file. Okay, this is the same program written in a script file. And we'll run it using awk-f. Okay? So I'll just run this. I'll just run this file. So awk-f and annual.awk, and I'll pipe the input into it. So it's giving some kind of a weird result. Okay? It's not printing what we want. So something is wrong with this file. So yesterday, I don't remember who, someone asked me if they can put the opening brace after the address like this. Okay? So I said yes. But it turns out you can't. Okay, you have to have your brace over here. Okay, now why is that? It's because now if you read the awk documentation, and this shows how important it is to read the documentation. Okay, So if you read the awk documentation, the awk documentation says that you can have an address, okay, or an action. This is an action, okay, a block. You can have an address or a block, but you can omit any one of them. Okay, you can have an action without an address, or you can have an address without an action. Okay, so if you have an address without an action, what does it mean? You have some address which matches some lines, but no block. So what does it mean? Okay, so awk says that, the awk language says that if you have such a block, if you have a block, so if you have an address like this, and nothing after that. Okay. Now awk, if it sees something like this, an address without a block, it assumes that it is this is equivalent to this. Okay. So if you have an address without a block, this is what's actually going to happen. You understand? So that's what's happening in our output program. And in fact, this block is being executed for every line. Yes. So it's awk is looking at this. This looks fine, okay, because we don't have any addresses here. It sees this line, an address without a brace, and it does that. And it sees this pair of block, and it executes it for every line. So it's exactly what we don't want. So what you need to do to fix this is just move that block, that opening brace next to it. Okay. So now this address belongs to this block. Okay. So let's run that again. So it works now. Yes, and be careful. On a single line, no. A single line doesn't matter.
So mistake if we place a semicolon between the address and
yeah, so you can't put a semicolon between the address and the place. There should so that immediately after the address should be an opening place. Okay, but here inside the file a new line is coming in between. Isn't that confusing? So I'll just show you one more example. It's another climate file. Okay. Look at this. This is a multi-line. Okay, the earlier file was single line. The single line, single data. Look at this file. This file has information, climate information about a particular station. Okay, so this is a name. The station, there's a station number. Okay, it has some name for the station. Information about that station means elevation above sea level. Okay, and then it's having some data for that station from 1991 up to 2000, I think, for each month, okay, arranged in columns. So it has mean station pressure, you go and down, now it has sea level pressure. It has a lot of information for one single station. Okay, monthly temperature, monthly precipitation, minimum temperature, a lot of information. And then the second station. Now we have state. Now this is the next record. Okay, we have another station. It has a different name. Okay, and the same information: latitude, longitude, elevation, all that stuff. Okay. Now how many? Let's open this file anyway. So it turns out this file has 39,699 files. Lines. 39,699 lines. Now we want to use this, suppose you want to make some kind of an awk script which allows you to search easily within this file for information about a certain station. So the regular way to do it would be to open the file and search for your station name. But we want to make an awk script. How do you do that? So first, we need to decide what should be our record separator and our field separator, right? So what's our record separator over here? Station number, right? This word station number is there on all the lines. You just verify it. So when you're using programs like awk and Sed and Awk, you really need to know what your data looks like. So look at that. So it's again station number and some 5-digit number and the name. Go to the next one. Again, station number, some 5-digit number, and the name. So that's a field separator. A record separator. So what's a field separator? Yeah, new line is a convenient field separator because we don't find any other convenient way of separating fields. So we'll keep the field separator as new line. So look at this extract. It returns an awk script. So in the begin block, I'm setting the record separator as new line station number. So I put the new line there so that because every record ends with a blank line, just like the email inbox. Okay, every station ends with a blank line plus the words station number. Now this dot is actually a regular expression dot. Okay, but it works over here. The reason is because it looks for, what does dot do?
Any single character,
right? Okay, so dot looks for one character. Now if you want to put a literal dot over there, you have to put a backslash. Okay, so actually ideally you're supposed to put a backslash dot over there because we're looking for the period, not for a single character. But it works. Okay, it works over here. So we set our record separator as the word station number dot and our field separator as new line. And what does this do? So this is the begin block. It's executed only once before the awk script runs. And this is our this is run for every record. Okay, every record. No more lines. We're talking about records now. So what does print $1 do? What's our field separator? New line, right? So it prints the first field. So what will it print?
The first line,
okay? It's going to print that line with the station number and the name of the station and all that. Let's run this. Cat, tables, pipe it through. So using awk-f because our script is stored in a file. Let's see the output. You see? Pipe it through less. Okay, we've got all our stations. Okay, all the stations and their names and the station numbers. Now, you remember what I told you about the first one, the first record? See that? Okay, you got a record separator in the first record. That's because it assumed that the file starting is the first record. But for all the rest, it's not there. Now what we need to do is we need to modify our script so that we can type something like awk-f, our script name, and we'll give the name of a city. Okay, we'll give a name of a city like this, and we should get something like mean pressure or something for that city. Okay. Instead of searching for the file, we want to write an awk script for it. So I've already written the awk script and I'll explain to you line by line. So using some new features which I didn't mention earlier. Okay, it looks a little big, don't worry about that. Okay, so I'll explain this part by part. Don't look at the whole thing. So this one is the same. Okay, the RS and FS is the same. Now, you remember, if you look at the man page for awk, it says that you can run awk like this. Awk program. Okay, program means your awk program, your awk commands. Okay, this is where we put the braces and all the commands and stuff. And after this, file. Okay. So if you write something like this and you put a file name, instead of awk reading, if you supply a file name, instead of awk reading from standard input, it's going to read this file. Okay, it's going to read this file, and for every record in this file, it's going to do this, run this program on it. Okay, but we want, instead of providing a file name, we want to provide a station name. Okay, we want to provide something like Istanbul or something. Okay, we want to call our script like this: awk-f extract 3.awk. Okay, this is the line that we want to work. But if you type something like this, awk is going to think that Istanbul is a file name and it's going to try to read it and it's going to say that file not found. Now, how do you fix that? Now, when you run an awk program, inside your awk script, there's an array called argv. So, we didn't talk about arrays I think most of you will know what an array is. An array is just, it's just a variable which can be subscripted with a number. Okay. So argv is an array. If you type argv 1, okay, argv 0 is the first value in that variable. argv 1 is the second. Okay, so suppose you wanted to store a list of values inside a variable, you would use an array. Okay, so suppose you wanted to store, for example, earlier we saw that table of your annual climate data. Suppose you stored each of those, you wanted to store all those climate data in one variable, you would use an array. And then if you wanted to get the first value from that list, you would use array bracket 0. Second one is array bracket 1. Okay, so on. Now this is an array which is present, which is set by awk itself. You remember the nr variable and the nf variable, something like that. It's created by awk itself. So argv1 is going to contain this. Okay. Do you remember $1 from the shell? Right. It's the same. It provides the same function argv1. So argv1 has this value. And argv2 has the same content as $2 in your shell, right? So now we know that we can capture this word. So you're typing an argument, you're typing a command line argument after your awk script. We can get that word. So we'll copy this, we'll copy the word Istanbul, our word, into the variable called station name in our begin block. Now look at this line. We're doing delete argv1. Why? Because as soon as awk is done with the begin block, when it goes into this block, it's going to start reading its input. Okay. So now you remember what the man page says? It's going to think that this is the input. So we need to somehow prevent awk from reading this file, from trying to open this file called Istanbul. So what do you do? The easiest way is just delete that option. We delete that command line argument. So over here we delete argv1. So now awk never sees. Okay, the awk, when awk reaches the second block, it never sees this argument because the argument has been deleted. Okay, so this is something which is peculiar to awk, and you need to do it because awk expects a file name. So it's expecting a file name. You're collecting that word over there, and then you're hiding it from awk. So you're going to delete it. So you just put delete argv1. Awk never sees the word Istanbul. So now since there's no file name, it's going to start reading from standard input, right? So it's doing what we want. This should be in begin. So as soon as, within the begin block, awk does not open the file yet, okay? Once it exits the begin block, then it's going to try to open its file name arguments. So this is something, it's something weird, okay? It's peculiar to awk, but it's something you need to do if you want to pass command line arguments to awk. So we've got a station name, which we're looking for. Now we need to look through our records and find the station name, which is matching, and print out the information which we want. Okay, so let's just look at the input file once again. Okay, so look, there's mean station pressure. Suppose we want to type we'll write a program so that you give a city name. Okay, and it's going to print out mean station pressure for that. Okay, not all the other data, just mean station pressure. Okay. So you look at the program.
Just open that file.
Okay. Yeah.
So here that RB1 would be that entire station number 085, that whole thing. Right?
Oh no. So RB1. So suppose you type this command at your prompt. Okay, you type this command at the prompt. This value, the first command line argument after awk-f file name, this word will be stored in this variable, argv1. It's not related to your input file. Okay?
Okay. So it will...
Yeah, so we just want to get this from the command prompt into your program, into your script. Okay? So in your begin block, you have not started reading your input yet. Okay? Begin block runs before everything else. So we haven't opened any file, we're not reading standard input, nothing has been done. What we're doing is we're taking this command line argument and storing it in some variable, and then deleting it. So we're deleting it. We're deleting it so that awk never sees this. Because if awk sees this, it's going to think it's a file. It's going to try to open it.
After deletion, how would it store?
So we copy it to another variable, right?
Okay.
We copy it to the variable station name. So over here, we're copying it to the variable station name. Then we can delete it because we already have a copy safe. Now this is our main block of the program. So what's this block going to do? It's going to read one station record. That means starting from station number up to the next station number is going to read all the lines. Okay? And that line is going to be stored in. Now there's one variable which I didn't tell you about yesterday. Okay? So you know that $1 inside your awk program, $1 has what? The first field, right? $2 has the second field. What does $0 contain?
The whole record.
Exactly, it contains the whole record. It contains all of these. So if you do, so I told you, right? So earlier we did something like this, right? In our first awk program, this is what we did, right? We just put print just like that inside a block. This is actually equivalent to saying print $0, okay? It's exactly the same. I think they both mean the same. So that's $0. So now $0, so on each iteration, when so awk is going to read one record, that means beginning from one station number up to the second station number. It's going to store everything in $0, and then it's going to do a splitting. Okay, it's going to split along new lines. So $1 will have the first line, the one with your station number, station name, everything. $2 is going to have all the rest of the data. So what we need to do, we're supplying a city name. And we need to find that city name within $1. Okay, $1 has your line, station number, and then the name of your city. So we look at the file once again. Go here quickly. It's a little complicated, but I'm trying to show you in the real world what kind of things you can do with awk in the real world. So look at the name of the city. It's a city, comma, country. So we look at the output of our original script file, that extract one. So see, it's city, country, city, comma, country. So that's how it's separated. There's a comma separating the name of the city and the country. Okay, so we'll use that when we're writing our script. Not those lines, the lines from your input. Okay, so I'll just open the original one. Just tell you one second. Okay, this is your original input.
That's right.
Now we put RS equals to our station number dot, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you put FS as new line. So now awk is going to start reading your input. It's going to start reading from here. It's going to go down. And as soon as it sees each new line, it's going to assign it to $1, $2, $3. Okay, until when? Until it hits the next station number. Okay? So when awk reaches here, it's going to stop. Okay? When it stops here, now your block, that block which you have, you can do whatever you want in that block, and everything you do in that block operates on whatever was read until now. Okay, once your block ends, it's going to start reading from here, go down until the next station number. So from here until the next station number is your record, and each line within this, between this station and next station, is your field. Okay, clear? So if something not clear, please ask, because it's a little complicated, it's a little complex example to show you how you can use all the features of awk to do something really useful. Okay, so we got a $1. Okay, $1 is our first line of our station data. Now we want to look for the city name in that. Now first we use regular expressions to actually pull out the city name from that line. Okay, you want to extract the city name from that line. So how do you know that there's a city name over there? I think it's better open it. It's another terminal so you can see it. So see, this part of the command, this part of the file is also standard. You have a station number, a file is a station name, a colon, And after the colon comes your city name, comma, country name. So that's followed everywhere. Then let's go down under lines. Okay, look at that station number. It's a little too low. So look at this station number. Again, station number, 5-digit number, colon, city, comma, country. So we can use this colon to know that the city name is going to begin. Okay, and when we see a comma, we know that the country name is going to begin. Right? So we'll use that in a regular expression. Okay, so look at our program. Now this match. Now I told you yesterday that Awk is a complete programming language. It has your for loop, if, everything, okay, while loop. It has some built-in functions also. Okay, it has some built-in functions which can do regular expression, matching, regular expression. Even the, you remember the sed s command? What does the s command do? Substitutes, right? So Awk has a function which does the same thing. It has a function which substitutes some string. So I'll show you that. So look at this first function, okay, match. Match, what does match do? Match has three arguments, okay, three parameters you have to pass to the match function. The first parameter is a variable name. We're giving it $1. $1 is what our first line. Okay? And the second argument is a regular expression. The second argument is a regular expression. And the third argument is the name of a variable. So what this is going to do, what's a match function is going to do, it's going to look for this regular expression inside this variable. If it finds a match, it's going to store that match over here. Okay, so you remember in sed, when you're looking for a match, where does it store it? Like if you put the first bracket, where does it store it? /1, right? It stores it in /1. Now this is like, some, it's similar to that, but in storing in /1, you can store it in a particular variable. Now suppose you have more than one set of brackets, one set of parentheses. Okay? In that case, match is going to store it in array. Okay? It's going to treat this variable as an array. So if you look at, so if you have more than one bracket in your regular expression, it's going to treat that variable as an array. So STN match 1 will have whatever this first bracket has matched. Okay? And STN match 2 is going to have whatever second set of brackets matched. Okay? Now look at this regular expression. Does it make sense? We have a colon. Okay? Inside the brackets we have dot star. Okay, dot means any character, star means zero or more of that, followed by a comma, followed by any more characters, okay, dot star, okay, that's it. So it's going to look, it's going to search, scan through your $1, it's going to find a colon, and then it's going to look for any character until it hits the comma, okay, so it's going to stop at the comma. And whatever it saw until then, until the last comma, it's going to store it in STN match 1. And after the comma, it looks for some more alphabets. Okay, it looks. So dot star means what? It's going to go till the end of the line. Okay, dot star means anything. So after the comma, it's going to capture whatever comes after the comma, it's going to capture into STN match 2. Okay? So we've got a country name and we've got a city name. Now this G sub, this G sub is the S command in Awk. Okay, it's the S command in Awk. So this is a regular expression, this is your replacement, and this is a string. So what are we doing over here? Okay, I put a space and a plus inside this regular expression. That means what? One or more spaces, right? One or more spaces. One or more consecutive spaces. So what this command does is it's going to look at this variable STN match. And if it finds one or more spaces, it's going to replace it with a single space. So why I did this? Because in some of the country names, if you look at the input file, the names of the cities have spaces in them. But not one space, they have more than one space. So if you're going to do the search on a command line, it's not going to find it because we are expecting one space, but the file has more than one space. So when we find more than one space, we squeeze it into a single space. That's what the G sub command does. Okay? So we're doing this for the city name and the country name. Okay? We just need to do it for the country name. Now this is a regular if statement in Awk. So forget the tool over, okay? I just write it plain. Like that. So if you write something like this, STN match. One. Station name. Have you seen this operator before? It's new, right? Suppose I put this. What's it going to look for? It's going to look if the station name exactly matches whatever is stored in a regular expression capture. Okay? Stem match one. We could use that. But I'm using this. What does this do? This treats this as a regular expression. Okay, it treats this station name as a regular expression and then matches this regular expression with whatever is contained in this variable. Okay, it sounds like the same thing, right? Putting equal to and putting this. But when you put equal to, it treats this as a string. If you put this tilde, it's going to treat it as a regular expression. Now, let's make a difference when you run it. I'll tell you that. Now, awk by itself doesn't support awk. In the language itself, it doesn't support case insensitive matching. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll put this stm match 1 and pass it to the toLower function. What toLower does is going to convert all the uppercase to lowercase, like we did in our shell program, remember? So we're going to do a lowercase matching between stm match 1 and our station name. So toLower is a built-in function in awk. Okay, you pass it a string, it's going to return the string with all the uppercase convert to lowercase. So see, there's an if statement. You have to put the condition for the if inside parenthesis. Okay, this is like C, okay, unlike the shell. You have to put the condition inside the parenthesis. And this block, see this block, beginning over here, ending here. This block is the full if block. Okay. Now in our file, we want to print mean something pressure. Okay. So if you look in the input file is very structured. We found that line 4 up to line 23, okay, up to line 22, is having your mean station pressure, okay, within a record. So suppose you took the first record, if you count 1, 2, 3, 4, line number 4 is where your mean station pressure data starts, okay, it ends at line number 23, right? So we put a loop over here, okay, this is exactly like a C loop for those of you programming C. Many of you maybe don't use C. So this is a for loop, okay, just like the other for loop. What this loop does, it's going to loop from the value 4, okay, up to value 22. Okay, we put less than I, less than 23. So it's going to loop until 22. Okay, and it's going to print $i. Now awk behaves a little differently from the shell. Okay, when it sees a dollar, it's not going to do any substitution or anything like that. But when it sees a variable name, it's going to substitute it over there. So awk sees an I over here. So what's it going to substitute I with? It's going to substitute it with the value of inside the loop. So in the first iteration, it's going to substitute with 4. In the second iteration, it's going to substitute with 5, 6, 7, up to 22. So in effect, your print line is print $4, print $5, print $6, like that. Okay, it's going to print all those mean pressure lines. Close all the brackets, we're done with our program. Let's run it. So cat tables, we pass it through awk, FNF, program. Now you need to provide an argument. Okay, so we'll provide the name, standard. Okay, I'll pass it through less. So now see what you got. You got the information for Istanbul, okay, Turkey. You got the mean station pressure. That's it, nothing else. We've extracted the data from it. Now I told you, I'll tell you the difference between that equal to and that tilde. So notice the name over here. Okay, it's not just Istanbul. Okay, it's got something slash Istanbul. Okay, so the exact string is not Istanbul. So if we change our script, if we change this to equal to instead of the tilde, okay, what's going to happen? Suppose we run the same command, what's going to happen? Is it going to find it? It won't find it. So nothing, we didn't get anything. The reason is if you put an equal to, it's going to search for that exact string. It's going to search for that exact string Istanbul. But if you use a regular expression, it's going to search for that word anywhere inside your string. Okay, remember in Sed, that word state house, you were searching for TEH, we found the TEH inside the state house. It's the same thing. You're searching for station name you're searching for the regular expression station name in this variable. If it's present anywhere in this, it's going to give a success. Okay? If it finds anywhere here, it's going to give true. But the equal to is going to match the string exactly. Okay? So here it works better for us if we use this. So we don't have to give the full name of the CPU. So we'll change it back. So program works, we'll give some other city. Okay. So this works. Okay. We're able to extract the data which we want. Okay. So it's doing what we want. So that's something like a little bit complicated but real world kind of example. So it shows you flexibility of Awk. Okay, it was a little long, I know, the example, maybe a little confusing, but you can look at the example and try working on your own files. Okay, so I think that, sorry? Which argument? Oh, yeah. So I wanted to tell you that this file is not perfect. It's not very well structured like the previous one. So line 4 to 23 in this particular record does not have that mean pressure. It has this data in place. So what I'm trying to say is that you need to know your data properly before you do anything. So you can improve this program. Maybe that's an exercise. You should improve this program so it searches for mean pressure. Okay, and then prints out only that. Okay, so that's your exercise. Okay, I think we'll stop for later. Thank you.